cuando desempaques tus regalos, niño de lujosa vecindad. Piensa en tantos niños que no saben para qué es la Navidad. Piensa en el chavalo limpiabotas, que su noche buena pasará en una banqueta dura y fría del atrio de catedral.
¡Feliz Navidad! ¡Feliz Navidad! ¡En justicia y libertad! ¡Feliz Navidad!
Welcome to the Magnificast, a podcast about Christianity and leftist politics, and most recently about Christmas time. I'm Dean Detloff. I am your elf workshop quality control tester.
And I'm Matt Vernico. I'm just the red-nosed reindeer.
Well, I really usurped that role pretty quick. This week we are talking with Brent Plate, who has a very cool and very long official title. He said we could use it or not use it, and we've decided to use it. So I'm going to tell you in full. He is Associate Professor of Religious Studies and Cinema and Media Studies by special appointment at Hamilton College, a title that we could all aspire to. Brent has written several books and essays, including a recent one with Columbia University Press called Religion in Film, Cinema, and the Recreation of the World. Since it is still technically Christmas time, we asked Brent to talk with us about why we all love those good, good Christmas movies that we love so much. So we start off the interview asking Brent what his favorite Christmas movie is, and then we dive in from there, but we didn't really admit ours. So Matt, what is your favorite Christmas movie?
My favorite Christmas movie, it's a really recent adoption of mine, but it is The Nightmare Before Christmas.
Okay.
My parents wouldn't let me watch it when I was a kid because a Focus on the Family said it was too dark. But now that I'm an adult and I can handle this and make my own decisions about movies, I love it. My son loves it. Collectively, we are Jack the Pumpkin King, and it's great.
Now that you can focus on your own family.
I can focus on my own family. Yeah, man, my son, Lewis, he loves Oogie Boogie, even though he's like the scariest bad guy I've ever seen, but he's all about him.
We had a VHS tape of that movie that we did watch when we were kids, and my younger sister, she doesn't listen to this podcast, so I'm going to tell the story. She was very afraid of Oogie Boogie, and we did conveniently lose that VHS for a couple years, and it did mysteriously resurface when she was older and felt like she could handle it. So I'm not saying she did steal it, but I'm not saying she didn't. In any case, she's over it now. She does like it, as far as I know. But yeah, good pick.
It's a great movie. There's so much cool visual stuff, lots of good stop motion animation. My son, when he watched it for the first time, he's four. He's probably too young to watch it, but I'm a bad parent, so what can you do? I asked him if Oogie Boogie was too scary for him. He said, no, he's just bugs. So tell that to everyone.
He's right.
Afraid of Oogie Boogie. He's just bugs underneath it all.
That's all. Aren't we all just bugs at the end?
That's right. Dean, what's your favorite Christmas movie?
Man, there's so many to choose from, but I have to say National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation is probably my favorite. And I don't know exactly why, except that my dad really loved the scene where the main character, Chevy Chase, is sitting in his, or standing in the living room, and he gets a glass of eggnog and has a very long rant. And he concludes the rant by yelling, hallelujah, holy shit, where's the Tylenol? And my dad would say that himself throughout the year during ordinary time when it was no longer Christmas. And it became a really good running joke in our family. So I do still love the where's the Tylenol line.
Hallelujah, where the hell's the Tylenol is big dad energy. That's the biggest dad energy.
There's also constantly. A great... I also love their neighbors. Julia Louis-Dreyfus plays one of them, but they are like these extremely bougie, I don't know what they do, but like capitalist couple who despise their neighbor. And I love it. It's a really good, incredibly soft, but very funny critique of young professionals. I always like that a lot.
That's great. Cool. Well, there you go. There, those are our Christmas movies. That those are our fave Christmas movies. You know, tweet us yours. Let's get this Christmas movie vibe going and a big watch list. What's the most radical Christmas movie? What's the most communist Christmas movie, Dean? Do you know? Because I don't.
Oh boy, you don't.
No, I thought this would be a great setup to a joke, but I don't have one.
There's so many. I mean, A Christmas Carol, it's almost there because Marx did like Dickens, and there's that really troubling scene where that one Christmas ghost opens his robe and there's two starving kids, and they represent like poverty and that sort of thing. That's pretty wild.
Right.
That one's close. Scrooged. That one's pretty Scrooge. Close, but Donald Trump is in that movie.
Another movie that was too scary for me to watch when I was a little kid. That last ghost is too scary in there.
In Scrooged?
Yeah.
That is a spooky ghost.
Yeah, the spooky ghost, man. Christmas movies have a lot of ghosts in them, I'm realizing right now.
by spooky ghost, you do mean Bobcat Goldthwait, right?
Yeah, that's what I mean, yeah. Okay, well, you tweet us what you think is the most communist Christmas movie, because we have no idea. But let's get to Brent and his very good interview.
This week on the show, we're talking to Brent Plate. He's a professor of religious studies and cinema and media studies at Hamilton College. He's a scholar of media and religion. Brent, you've done a lot of work on things like film and material culture. We're going to get to that in a moment. But just to set up this episode, we have to ask you a very important initial question, and that is, what is, after all, as a professor of religious studies and media and cinema, what is your favorite Christmas movie?
Oh yes, right to the most important things. yeah, I've got three of them that I watch pretty much every year, and I think it changes from year to year which one's my favorite. But the top two are either and everybody's going to groan, but It's a Wonderful Life, and the second one is A Christmas Story. And the third one, which always is sort of somewhere in the top, is Elf with Will Ferrell.
Hmm.
So right. those are the three. And then sort of extend a little bit farther. Bad Santa, I end up kind of rewatching quite a bit, and a couple others. So
that's great. Those are good choices. I like that a lot.
Yeah, it's a good gamut of genre and time and everything.
Yeah, trying to get, I mean, they definitely, you know, it's nothing, they're all kind of at the tops of most people's lists, but, you know, I think there's a reason for that, I definitely defend the top two as being, you know, just kind of important movies in a lot of ways.
Yeah, I think you're right. All right, well, you're here talking to us about Christmas and film and media. We thought it'd be cool to talk to you because you wrote these two really nice articles about Christmas and material culture, and also Christmas and cinema. So, I don't know, what's the connection there? Like, why are you interested in Christmas at all? Like, what's the connection between religion and media and Christmas?
Well, most of my work is looking at how religion, you know, religious traditions and in the wake of secularism become, how rituals and myths and symbols sort of continue on in the world and even with the sort of secularization of societies, you know, fewer and fewer people, you know, claim religious adherence, and yet more and more people go to sporting events and pay money for entertainment and join together in all kinds of different ways. So I'm really interested in this kind of relation of the secular and the religious through the lens of sort of pop culture and media, I think as sort of contemporary conveyors of our religious sensibilities, our creators of our communities, our creators of, you know, values and meaning and purpose and things like that. So I think Christmas is certainly one of those kind of nuggets, one of those sort of places to really look as kind of a case study of how this occurs in this kind of, you know, the secularized holiday. Just even the, you know, even the movies that I just mentioned, right, really have nothing to do. I'm not even sure any of them even mentions Jesus in them. You know, maybe Jesus and Jesus Christ come up in maybe a song that's sort of sung somewhere in the films, but they don't, you know, there's nothing really at all about sort of this being a Christian holiday in any of these stories. And so I'm kind of interested in that, you know, and to hear this ostensibly Christian holiday time of Christmas, and it's sort of been, I don't want to say evacuated of the Christian meaning, because I think, you know, as anybody who knows the sort of history of history of Christmas and Christianity knows, it's certainly kind of all a made up thing anyway. It really isn't a consistent, there isn't a consistent way of thinking about it through the last couple thousand years. So, Christmas becomes a way to kind of connect economics and cultural life and media life and religious life. So it's kind of a fun way to think about that. The other side, I'll just say briefly and we'll come back to, but I'm really interested in the reinventions of rituals. I'm really interested in how rituals get remade. You know, they're not, they don't stick around because they're the same old thing all the time. They stick around because they're retold and somebody tweaks things in them and they morph and they adapt into different kinds of ways. So I'm interested in the morphing and tweaking that's happened at Christmas time as a ritual.
That's great. That's a really good way to open up the conversation here. And I'm excited to talk more about exactly that, the tweaking and how Christmas got made up. Maybe a good place to start would be this article that you wrote for Religion News Service. The title is Technology, Tradition, and the Invention of Christmas in 19th Century New York. So last week we talked to another scholar kind of in this orbit, Pamela Clausen, about what you called the public work of Christmas. I think what's really fascinating about your article is the story that you tell where that public work, the way that this sort of holiday accumulates rituals and that sort of thing, is also a pastiche of private interests and companies and, you know, people really kind of latching onto it. Could you tell us a little bit about how New York as a sort of innovation hub gave rise to this big and wild holiday that we know today?
Yeah, it was, kind of a chance to sort of going back through history and finding just all these things that seem to have happened in New York City, especially in the 19th century. For one, it was just through the 19th century, New York City, of course, was this flood of immigration and sort of the central hub for immigration for the United States, people particularly coming from Europe. And it was just this mishmash of peoples and ethnicities and languages and cultures around New York City. And there was no real coherent Christmas at the time. So because everybody had their own customs. I mean, it just sort of shows that, you know, just the diversity that is Europe itself. Right. We sort of tend to think of, oh, they're sort of, I don't know, somebody's Euro-American as if this is a monolithic thing. But, Europe has these, you know, fairly rich, distinct traditions. And all these cultures came together in New York City and didn't really understand each other's traditions. And you had these different theological ideas going on and some of the sort of more Protestant, more strictly Protestant groups were very, you know, into the Bible and into the sort of aniconic traditions of Protestantism. And so the idea of Christmas was really anathema to them and didn't celebrate in any kind of way. But then there were other groups who did celebrate it a bit more. So there was no coherence to it. So finally they, you know, through a number of things, and it was probably Washington Irving in certain ways who really started to kind of want to get people together and started writing these stories and wrote this sort of history, this Knickerbocker history of New York and just made a lot of stuff up, of course. But with it, it brought some ideas together and brought some people together. And so it was sort of this political, social movement, but then they had to add these cultural events, and they begin to have big feasts, and of course it was Sinterklaas, and his day was December 6th, and they had to somehow translate that, get that to be Christmas Day, which was already December 25th, and so all the, you know, a number of things had to happen to, I won't go into all the details of it, but it was a social, it was a political, it was a cultural, it was an economic work of many people in a number of different situations that sort of coalesced and sort of created what we think of. I think most of us anyway, if you, this kind of traditional idea of Christmas and things like Santa Claus and gifts and Christmas trees and lights around the Christmas tree you know, stockings and giving gifts to each other at this time of the year. All this were sort of bits and pieces of different cultures that sort of amalgamated into this one time. It's hard to say that I think there were definitely a lot of this was economic interest, but it certainly wasn't solely driven by that. Some of it was political interest, but I don't think it's reducible to that either. So it's this real interesting kind of, I think, mixture of all those things. And by looking at Christmas, you can think about the political, the economic, the social, as well as the, religious dimensions, if we're allowed to sort of bracket that part out from those other things for a while.
Yeah, that's a helpful explanation. Well, the story in that article that you tell, it goes from a moment where Christmas is, culturally scattered, all these different types of practices or no practices at all, kind of irrelevant to the public, I suppose. But it goes from that to a moment where it's just a national public holiday that consumes all of our attention for like 2 months. One thing that really sticks out in that story is how some corporate and entrepreneurial symbols get tied up in that holiday. I mean, you just said that it's not all just economics, it's politics too, and stuff like that too. But I think of things like that you mentioned like Coca-Cola making Santa a mascot or Thomas Edison string lights around a tree. Is it fair to say that Christmas is a holiday that is made up by capitalism, or is that too reductive? Is there more going on there?
Well, of course, I mean, its roots, of course, whatever its roots are, if there are any single roots to it, it certainly, precedes capitalism, sort of thinking of it strictly speaking. There were Christian celebrations of it for, hundreds of years before this. They weren't quite what we think of today and all that sort of been invented. So, I mean, I think the modern, what we think of from the sort of early 21st century as Christmas. Yeah, I'd say that. Yeah, a lot of that is certainly invented by capitalist interests. I tend not to sort of reduce anything down to one cause. It's always a little more complex than that. I'm not sure everybody who really had a hand in it was doing it out of purely capitalist kinds of interests. I mean, I think Thomas Nast, the illustrator, is kind of an interesting character. Of course, he's making money off his illustrations, but he really gives the shape to Santa Claus. And in part, I never knew him. He died a long time ago, but it's hard. I have a hard time sort of believing that all he was interested in was making money. I mean, he was an artist, and he was kind of interested in artistic creation on one hand. I have a colleague here who's collected his prints pretty and written an entire book on Thomas Nast, and it's kind of a really intriguing character in a lot of ways as a 19th century illustrator. So a lot of visual imagery we have comes from Thomas Nast. Of course, then it's quickly picked up by Coca-Cola, who does their own twist on it, and Coca-Cola is certainly responsible for promulgating the image of Santa Claus and a lot of our Christmas ideas, visual Christmas ideas, as well. But before that, it's Thomas Nast and publishing in Harper's Weekly, particularly in the late 19th century.
Yeah, I mean, that's always helpful to make the story a little bit complicated and see what's all going on there. Well, I think that's all a good way of setting the stage for a conversation around Christmas. But we were also really intrigued by another article that came out more recently called What Makes Christmas Movies So Popular, that you wrote. It was republished at Salon. That's where we saw it. But it's kind of made the rounds at a few places. And you explain there exactly what you think is going on in Christmas movies. And there's a lot of interesting pieces to it that we'll be able to pull out. But maybe just to start, you have this suggestion that there's a ritual element to Christmas movies in the sense that they become part of the rhythm of the holiday. And you mentioned even at the top of the episode that you have these three that you always like to watch. Could you tell us a little bit about Christmas film as ritual? How does that operate? Why is that sort of an interesting way of looking at this? And maybe if you have any insight as to why do we do that at Christmas time with these sort of films in a way that we don't tend to do, in most other times of the year?
Yeah, I mean, I think part of it is, ritual studies 101. We do one main type of ritual are the, you know, seasonal or calendrical rituals and things that happen on a, you know, weekly basis or a monthly basis or a yearly basis or something like that. And so I think it's, you know, it has its place there. It's something we do one time a year, and it's, in ways, it's special because it's only one time a year. And you pull out the, you know, you pull out the Christmas tree, but you also pull out the DVDs or however you might have them, and watch these things once a year. And I think a few things happen. One is it reminds us. I mean, Christmas is certainly this contemporary construction is certainly all about nostalgia. And for instance, A Christmas Story, certainly one of my favorites, and I think a lot of people's top at the top of their list is a movie done in the 1980s, but sort of reflects on a time in the 1950s. And it's, you know, the idea that life was much simpler back then. And all I wanted was a Red Ryder BB gun. You know, that was the most important thing in the world. And, you know, that's just full of nostalgia. And it's, you know, when it's nostalgia is a terrible way to live overall in life, but it's not a bad thing to dip into from time to time. And I think in part rituals help us relive or reconstruct something from the past. And, you know, whether it's a Passover Seder that's, you know, reliving and reactualizing the emancipation from slavery in Egypt and wandering through the wilderness, and at the beginning of the evening in the Seder were enslaved peoples, and at the end were liberated peoples, and we reenact that on a yearly basis. And I think you know, in the same kind of way, I don't want to put it up there with a Passover Seder, but in the same kind of way, something is going on a yearly basis. We get a chance to sort of relive earlier, ideally simpler times, right? There's sort of this, it's our personal mythologies, I think, come out at these times where we reflect on the past, reflect on an easier time in life. So it tends to be a lot of nostalgia involved with it, but I think it can also be a critical nostalgia. I don't just want to sort of make it all sort of some easily overly sappy kind of thing, although I think that might be an important part of it. I think, too, we can be critical about our past. And I think I have this experience. So I watch A Christmas Story. I've probably seen it 20 times now, you know, since it came out over the years. I haven't watched it every year, but quite a few of the years. And I can watch it and I think, oh, yeah, I remember that time I was watching it, and I was living here, right, in this place, and I can think of the apartment I lived in, and I can think of the people I was around when I watched it, and I can think about who I was at that time. You know, maybe I was a graduate student, maybe I was, in college, maybe I was taking time off and trying to work and something else, living through some tragedy of a friend's struggles. So I use these times. I reflect. I don't mean to, but it's sort of something that happens to me when I watch the films again and again. As I remember where I was when I watched it before. So it's not, you know, it's not so much the content of the film. It's the structure. It's the formal dimensions of being sitting in a place and being overwhelmed by images and sounds. And these things sort of transport me back, just as they do in a, you know, traditional religious ritual. The idea is that it appeals to our senses in various ways and moves us bodily so that we reflect on maybe a former time, a place we were as a community, as an individual. It triggers, you know, there are triggers in our, you know, in our lives. So I think in a simple way how rituals work. And I think that's how sort of having these films this one time of the year work. There's something we return to again and again over the years. And in returning and in seeing them, we learn more about ourselves and our communities and what's valuable to us and maybe how we've changed through time. But then there's just the physical, just the bodily dimensions, the sights, the sounds of it all, and being in a particular place. That it's, you know, ritual is very embodied, and I think media get to a sense of that embodiment in ways that you know, perhaps just reading a text doesn't quite do.
Well, apart from just the rhythmic nature of the, you know, film as ritual, the content of those films end up meaning quite a bit as well. In your article, you go on to say that, you know, Christmas films don't show us the world that we do live in, but instead they show us an idealized world that we could aspire to. And that is a pretty, I think, on point idea. One of my wife's favorite movies is The Family Stone. And it's a good movie, I guess. I don't know.
It is. Yeah, it is.
But what's so interesting to me about it, I mean, it kind of clicked in my brain once I read the line from you about that, is that, you know, it's this film about this huge family, and there's a new person that comes to, you know, their family Christmas dinner, Sarah Jessica Parker. And, you know, there's like all of this tension, and what happens is that they just like work through the tension and they kind of accept her into the family. And that is an idealized world that we can aspire to. Definitely not the world that we live in. That's not the holidays that I know for sure.
Yeah.
But yeah, I don't know. I think that's such an interesting observation that Christmas movies are about the world that we could aspire to. So I guess based on your observations, what is the world that we should aspire to in Christmas movies, and how do they communicate that?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's the world. I mean, I think there's worlds that we, you know, to be moral or ethical about it, I think there's worlds that maybe we should aspire to, and then worlds that we want to aspire to. You know, those are sometimes, you know, sometimes those are similar things, and sometimes those aren't necessarily. But I mean, in the bottom line, most of the stories are the same, right? All these Hallmark movies, and I know some very intelligent people with advanced degrees who just love to sit in front of the Hallmark, the real kind of cheesy romance. And they'll admit that it's cheesy romance, but they love to sit and watch them. It's because I think it's, you know, it's a simple, here are these people, and then tension happens, and then resolution happens, and they're together in the end, right? It's got to have a happy ending to it. And so this, it's a desire for to not be alone. You know, I mean, it's just as, in some ways, it's just as simple as that. It's not good for humans to be alone. And these stories repeat that message again and again. In the end, we want to be together with other people. We want these tensions to go away. We want these struggles, the fights, the, you know, whatever it is that's keeping us from each other. We want those things to be overcome so that we can be together again, whether it's a romantic sense of being together, a familial sense of being together, or anything along the way. And the films just, they give us that, right? Wrapped up in 90 minutes time, you've got the tensions, you've got the possibility that it's all going to be okay in the end. And so I think they, you know, it's a, and I think certain people would critique that and say that's, you know, that's an, not a realistic view of life. But I'm not sure, again, sort of back to the ritual things, I'm not sure rituals are, we're not meant to live in rituals. They're just glimpses of things. They're just possibilities of things. It's what we do when we read literature, right? We play with the possibilities. What if this were to happen? What if this was the case? And it stretches our mind in various ways to play with these possibilities. Certainly there can be some dangerous parts, and people could just live in these kind of movies all the time and never really come out. I can, you know, sort of imagine that happening. But I think for most people, it's just it isn't just an escape. I mean, I think there is that element, and I don't think that's necessarily a bad part of it. But it's more than just an escape. It's actually a movement to something, movement into another world. And in that, there's a simple wish fulfillment to it, but it also might just provoke things in us. It might just actually change the ways we relate to other people. And I think there's actually good evidence that it does actually, watching these actually does change our chemistry, our ways of thinking. over time.
Yeah, I mean, everything that you're saying, I think, is exactly why I love watching a lot of Christmas movies all the time. And Christmas is my favorite holiday, even though I'm a pretty vulgar Marxist most of the time of the year. I like to, you know, give myself over to the just the holly jolly time. But I'm also sort of interested in the dangerous present there, too, and trying to play with those two things. I mean, so you end the article explaining Christmas films build this kind of world where all is right at the end. So, you know, in Jingle All the Way, it's spending your time with your family is more important than getting a Turbo Man action figure. Or in Elf, the real meaning of Christmas is connecting with your family. And so there is a sense in which Christmas films emphasize that Christmas isn't just about consumerism or presents. In fact, they sort of fight against that spirit of the holiday. And that's a really nice sentiment. But there's also, trapped between this kind of nostalgia and utopia, this tension, because Christmas is constructed out of our consumptive desires. And so there's this kind of strange, bifurcated reality that Christmas forces us to live into. So how do you think that we work out that tension, or what are some interesting ways of working out that tension during the holidays?
Yeah, I think that's really important dimension to it all. And I obviously we're all going to sort of come to it a little bit differently. I mean, and of course, these films are, you know, working within a capitalist film production structure. So even if they're sort of suggesting they're not, anti-materialist, they're within this sort of structure, this capitalist industrial film production. So people are making money off of these movies that pretend money isn't important. So I think I think there's things to be gleaned. I mean, on one hand, I think, sort of back to this ritual idea, that number of people have theorized about ritual as sort of this expenditure, this sort of excess. And, it's not, nothing's really sort of necessary in a sense in the midst of it. It's sort of extravagant excess. And, you know, I'm fascinated by that idea. Obviously there's, limits to all that. And then how do you create those limits, which, become kind of uncomfortable to sort of move around and think about in terms of the rituals and the excess. So I don't know. I'm not sure I have any easy answer to it. I try to move between kind of this, seemingly, try to think of myself as sort of a critical academic, but I'm also not interested in kind of suggesting that the general public who is spending a lot of time watching Hallmark movies is somehow wrong, in the midst of things either. And that to me comes the rub. I guess I'm sort of, I would love to do more research and try to figure out, what actually is going on in the minds, get people hooked up to, here's my dream project. Get 100 people and hook them up to fMRIs and scan their brains while they're watching Hallmark movies and figure out which parts of their brains are being worked.
Dang. I'm in for that study. That sounds great.
That's what I want to know. Yeah. And I'll be the first one to do it.
Yeah, the Hallmark center of the brain is definitely this light pattern.
It is somewhere next to the lizard, somewhere next to the lizard part. Ancient yeah, structures, I think.
I heard Lizard Christmas is the new Hallmark movie coming out this week.
There you go. That's.
Dang. Well, switching gears a little bit from Lizard Christmas, even though I would love to know what that movie's about, Dean, maybe later though. you wrote a book recently called Religion in Film, Cinema and the Recreation of the World. That clearly informs your look here at Christmas movies. Could you tell us a little bit about your theory of cinema there and how that illuminates the way Christmas movies recreate the world?
Yeah. So yeah, clearly a lot of the stuff I'm talking about with the Christmas movies is stuff I've been thinking about for quite a long time, in terms of religion and film more broadly, not just Christmas films. Actually, I think in the book, I don't think I mentioned any Christmas. I can't remember. It's a little while now since I actually wrote it, but I mentioned any Christmas films, or at least spending much time talking about them. But yeah, I think all films do this in various ways, you know, whether it's Star Wars or even horror films, in a lot of ways, they take us into another world. They transport us into another world. We sit and we're sort of, and it's not that, and again, it's not, I think thinking of film as escape is not, you know, it's not incorrect, but it's just not complete. We do sort of go to escape, and you know, I mean, I think about Walter Benjamin, who I did some work on earlier in my life. You know, sort of saw mass media as an important thing. He was sort of kind of had some disagreement, I think, with Adorno and Horkheimer over this, because he sort of thought, "Oh, this is good." You know, the masses have been working really hard, and they need some time off. And the movies, it's great to have an escape for them. And you know, I think there's something to that, but I think it's more than that. And of course, Benjamin knew this too. It was that they actually change our view of the world. So we go to the movies and we watch something, we walk out and we're actually different people. You know, something is shifted in our neural pathways. You know, it's opened up new channels of understanding things in the world. Our perspectives have shifted. So there's this idea that there's these two worlds that, you know, there's this world we live in and there's this world on screen and they're somehow separate. But I'm actually sort of interested in this kind of that cinema recreates the world. In other words, the sort of world that we live in. And so we go to watch the movies, but then they reflect back in our lives. And so we do things differently. There was a great article a couple years ago by, who was it? Was it, I think A.O. Scott, one of the New York Times film critics, talked about it. Had this great essay in the Times a few years back on kissing, and just went through all these kisses in films and talked about, you know, said we don't kiss anymore like we used to because we've been watching kisses in film for so long. And we have all these expectations of what a kiss should be like. And it's always, of course, different in the real world and the flesh and blood world, but it's changed the way we kiss and the way we approach other people when two faces come closer together. And it's just a great, you know, sort of thought to think about. Even our very intimate acts have been changed because of film, and I really think that's the case. So my book is sort of at first just start talking about the content of the films, to think about what happens. How are these films recreating the world? And I look at sort of the cinematography, I look at the editing, I look at the lighting, the mise-en-scène of a film, and sort of look at how the world is recreated through color and motion and form. But then I turn in the second half of the book to look at other elements. So the, you know, what I was sort of talking about a little bit earlier too, that there's this ritualized dimension involved, that it's not so much the content of the film, though that's important, but it is what happens when you get a group of people, they come together in one location, they all face forward, you know, facing this light coming, reflecting in their eyes, and they're transformed in a collective kind of way. You know, what happens to their bodies in the midst of these things? So then ultimately the ways we sort of leave the theater and how these things stick with us. So use a little example of the film Rocky from the 1970s. So Rocky, if you go to the Philadelphia Museum of Art, right, you go up to the top of the steps and you see Rocky's footprints up there at the top. And people, you know, tourists go there all the time. It's one of the top tourist attractions in Philadelphia, is to go up the steps of the Philadelphia Museum of Art and get to the top and jump up and down with your arms in the air like you're Rocky. Take a picture, and the internet's full of people standing at the top of the stairs. But of course, there's no such person as Rocky, right? He was just a fictional character, right? It wasn't, they're not talking about Sylvester Stallone here. His name doesn't show up. It's the name Rocky. And this is for all intents and purposes, a fake person. So I'm interested in that, how that sort of things on screen come down off the screen and actually enter into our lives and actually change, you know. What are you going to do when you go to Philadelphia? Well, I'm going to go to see the steps where Rocky ran up, right? And most people don't even know that it's the Philadelphia Museum of Art. And the Philadelphia Museum of Art, actually, there heard from people who work in the gift shop there. They say they're constantly bombarded with people who walk in and they're looking for Rocky paraphernalia in the Philadelphia Museum of Art. So it's this, you know, wonderful sort of clashing of worlds, I think, that happens in these kinds of places. So the tourist industry in New Zealand got this huge boost. I mean, it was something like 50% increase after the Lord of the Rings was filmed there. It was Peter Jackson is from there, so he filmed it there. And you know, never mind that it was based on a, you know, mid 20th century English professor who was writing these rewriting mythologies of ancient Norse and Northern European myths. And then the filmmaker films it in New Zealand. It's actually, you know, Middle Earth is New Zealand now, and people go there because they want to be in Middle Earth and they want to go to Hobbit Town. So these confusions, you know, and nobody, you know, actually thinks, okay, this is actually Middle Earth, but it's just this full on belief in or willingness, you know, or suspension of disbelief, I guess, really, this willingness to want to be part of this world, of this other universe. And, you know, there's something that, you know, I obviously they don't even really hopefully have to spell out the religious parallels with that. You know, these are worlds we want to go and we want to live in. They present themselves so attractively to us that we want to be part of these things. Those are kind of the larger things. I don't want to just be analyzing the content of the film. I want to think about how films are changing our lives off screen. And I think there's a lot of evidence that they are.
That makes a lot of sense. That reminds me a little bit of what Stuart Hall says in the essay Encoding Decoding. There's a line, I can't remember it off the top of my head really, but basically he's saying that, you know, violent movies don't make you violent. They just tell you what someone thinks about violence, right? It's what he's trying to say is that the point here is that when you see violence in a film, you're seeing like the way someone thinks about violence and not how it might actually be. But that kind of, I don't know, it resonates with what you're saying a little bit here in the sense that, you know, what you see is not reality, but you see an idealized world where a certain understanding or type of fantasy of violence or love or family life are all enacted. And then we, you know, we glimpse it and we want to be a part of it. And to me, when it comes to Christmas movies, it seems like there's a lot of catharsis bound up in it, right? Like you watch The Family Stone or Jingle All the Way or whatever, and you see how Christmas should be, and it feels like you know what's going on for a minute, or that there's some kind of better possibility out there, that maybe this year things will be different for you. I don't know. Do you have any feelings about catharsis in Christmas? Is there anything to it, or am I being very cynical?
No. I think definitely catharsis is part of it. I think definitely there are cathartic, you know, like ancient theater. I think there's something to it. I don't think it's always, you know, catharsis. I mean, I think there's other explanations and in other kinds of ways. But yeah, I think, you know, catharsis is part of it. There's a certain kind of, we follow the narrative arc. I'm a viewer. I go through the struggles. I'm there at the beginning. I'm there in the middle, and I'm there at the end. And things are wrapped up for me, and it feels, you know, I have a sense of completion at the end, a sense of fulfillment at the end. But there's, you know, there are films that, I mean, again, I sort of come back to It's a Wonderful Life, you know, which people I think unfairly critique as being, oh, it's too, you know, it's too nice. Everything, you know, turns out happy in the end, which of course it does. But the darkness of that film is deep. And if you really watch that film, the darkness is what's going to stick with you. You know, it's not the happy ending, you know, but made me feel good to walk out of the theater, get up from the couch afterwards. But that dark part, you know, where George Bailey gets shown the world without him. And, you know, I mean, it's heavy stuff, and, you know, he's contemplating suicide at this point in his life. And, you know, just some terrible things happen along the way. And it's, you know, just wanting to be done with his family, just wanting to be done with his own life. It's a great scene. I have kids, and there's a scene in the movie where he's just everything has fallen apart, and he talks to his wife. He says, "Why do we have to have all these kids anyway?" I say that around the house so constantly, you know. Just like, why do we have to have all these kids anyway? Just like, you're totally fed up with things at home sometimes, and that's always my response. I know, of course, why. My kids are great. I love my kids, but there are those moments when we feel like that. So I think there's catharsis, but then there's something, you know, in the really the better films, and I think film like that is just the power of the film comes out in that it's those dark moments that are the ones that sort of grip us and sort of stay with us for some time, and that sort of struggle and that search and that desire to find it. Not having found it at the end, that's the power. It's the quest for looking that really has the power in a film like that. I think there's more to just things being kind of wrapped up in the end. Hollywood sort of, you know, famous for wanting to tack on happy endings to things and no end to stories of directors who had disagreements with the production companies and wanted to leave things more open-ended, you know, and the production company said, "Nope, we're paying for this. We want this to be a happy ending." And, you know, Orson Welles and so many others had strong disagreements with the people with the money wanting to leave it open-ended. And Hollywood always wanted to wrap things up nice and neatly. But I think there are some of those films where it doesn't matter if it's wrapped up neatly in the end, it's actually, there's a whole lot of struggle to get there. And that struggle is really what makes the films interesting.
Well, I appreciate, Brent, that you've been fighting so strongly for how we can appreciate Christmas in the midst of all the craziness of it. I think it's really helpful for us to hear. No, it's good, especially because we've been doing some heavy material around Christmas in this podcast so far, so it's great to have somebody helping us figure out how to enjoy it. I'm gonna give you one more challenge. This is a question I thought about earlier after I read an article by D.L. Mayfield in The Lily, where she watched 10 Hallmark Christmas movies, the top 10, and just kind of tried to, you know, see what bubbled up for her. So this sort of goes back to what you were saying earlier, we'll see where it goes. So I want to read a little bit of a kind of longish quote, but I think it's a telling one. So she says, first of all, that in 2018, Hallmark was the most watched channel on cable among women ages 18 to 54 in the last quarter. So talk about, you know, recreating reality, I guess, for a certain demographic. And she says in a paragraph, "Of the top 10 films, every lead actor is white. Every relationship is heterosexual. every career person is inferior to a family type. Every small town in America understands the world better than the big city folks. Every family dispute can be solved by a big holiday dinner. Every person loves celebrating Christmas, regardless of their actual religion and traditions, long after the pleasant experience of watching good-looking people find non-controversial love amid a background of snow and twinkly lights fades. The questions remain, whom are these movies for, and what vision of the world are they upholding?" So these films aren't exactly the classics, of course, but she points out that they have the shaping power that you're talking about. And just talking a little more about these kinds of themes that you've been bringing up, I wonder a little bit, you know, do you think that this is kind of a reproduction of ideology that might be different than what was going on before in movies like A Christmas Story or Elf? You know, this is somewhat of a more recent phenomenon. Is this kind of more of the same? Is it just a new sort of ritualizing or recreating the holiday, like you said? You know, what's going on there? And I guess, yeah, how can we think about that sort of phenomenon?
Yeah, no, I mean, she's absolutely right on that. I mean, somebody, I don't know which film she's talking about, but yeah, I mean, even the ones that I've listed, you know, they're heteronormative. It's white people, you know, almost consistently. It's for a very particular demographic of people. And it's the seeing themselves in, yeah, it's the, you know, reflecting their own people's lives, what they want. They don't, it's a time people don't want to be challenged. Any of the challenges at this time of the year need to be contained. You know, I don't want to think too far beyond my, my comfort zone, you know. So things are reaffirming of certain people's lives, or they're, you know, maybe not reaffirming, but because I have no idea who's watching these films, and I really don't have the stories of the people who are watching them. And it's Christmas is of course a serious time for people with mental illnesses, and it's a very difficult time for many people. And so I think that's, you know, I don't know what the film, what some of these films do for people in those situations. But I think it would be an important question to ask and to think about further, all that. I mean, and granted, and I am in my book on religion and film, I'm very critical actually of the Hollywood film industry and the sort of, idiopathic kind of filmmaking, this sort of desire to always sort of reconstruct this, the same world again and again, where the white savior comes in and makes everything okay in various ways. So I don't want to sort of paint too rosy a picture of everything, because there's deep-seated racism in Hollywood, just continues. The Golden Globes Awards just the other day sort of shows the gender disparity that continues on in Hollywood, and I've written about this in a number of places. So yeah, I don't want to oversell too much of this, because there's some deep problems with it. I do think, I mean, I have read, and I'm really not at all an expert of these kind of, you know, as we sort of shorthand the Hallmark movies. It's not only Hallmark who's doing these movies, but it seems to be the kind of shorthand for it. As I understand it, there's been a number of sort of non-white, non-heterosexual stories that have been coming up, you know, with this sort of huge increase in them. They've been branching out, and there are, I do know there are, you know, stories of Latinos and African Americans as well, mixed in with some of these more dominant white people stories. I don't know what the ratios are. I mean, that would be kind of interesting to look at as well. But, you know, with that, and then more, you know, of course, the other thing is more Hanukkah stories. More and more Hanukkah stories are coming out, which, you know, is kind of a mixed thing. Of course, Hanukkah is not all that huge of a holiday on the Jewish tradition, but it's sort of becoming more and more a big thing because of this sort of capitalist push for Christmas. It's interesting how Hanukkah has become sort of nudged up in the importance of holidays over the years in modern United States.
Yeah, I should say Mayfield does end up, she concludes her article definitely not disparaging people who sort of want the narratives that you know, you might expect in a certain Hallmark film, but she points people toward Netflix and some others that have a bit more diversity in terms of representation or, you know, actors and that sort of thing. So maybe that sort of splits the difference a little bit. I guess you mentioned Walter Benjamin earlier. If I remember right, he also has this theory of film where he says, you know, one day when the revolution comes, then we'll truly find out what the workers think about film and cinema. So I guess the same might be said about Christmas.
Yes. Yes. I think that's it. Yeah, definitely. Yeah, I'm not sure if that things were different when Benjamin was alive. the revolution is going to look a whole lot different than it did at that point.
Yeah, that's for sure. Well, as we kind of get to the end of the hour here, I want to bring us back to this one phrase that Pamela Clausen introduced us to last week, which was she called Christmas a holiday of aggressive inclusion. which is a really suggestive phrase because it, on the one hand, has a, you know, the aggressivity could be positive or negative, and the inclusion too could be positive or negative. Just a really sort of fruitful kind of way of describing it. And I wonder, where, you know, you've done all this work on film and Christmas films and that sort of thing, and world building, etc. What do you make of that kind of phrase, that way of describing Christmas as aggressive inclusion, as all of us, you know, you flip through your television channels, and for sure, at least by the 20th second, you know, all of them are going to be running some kind of Christmas programming, some of them all day. What do you think that sort of says about the way that film functions in the ritualistic building of that aggressive inclusion?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, I think like, you know, like anything living in a sort of consumerist society, it just bombards us. It's just relentless in the, you know, desire for our attention and ultimately for our dollars. And I, you know, I resist that. I mean, my own life is sort of filled with fairly, sort of non-consumerist practices. And I actually don't spend a whole lot of time watching. I'm pretty really deliberate, actually, when I watch films. And I'm not someone, I really actually watch very little television and very few films. I'm interested in why people, I'm just interested in why people do and what is the need for it. I mean, I think it's, I'm afraid of being too cynical and sort of saying we're all just sort of pawns in a big, large corporate capitalist culture that's sort of giving us everything that we need to see. I go that way a lot of times. I think it's hard not to see that in certain ways. But I'm also, I guess I'm just always wanting to know what the average person is thinking and why they're doing what they're doing and why they're watching what they're watching. Some sort of belief. I was just rereading some article on Noam Chomsky recently. It was sort of, you know, back in the 60s, it's talking about the life of the intellectuals, and the problem with the, you know, intellectuals and academics is we think we've got it all figured out. We've got the critical responses, and the people just don't know what they're doing. And they need us to tell them, you know, how to think about war and how to think about peace. And he had a strong belief in people, the everyday person who's not an academic. And I tend to view the world like that, I think, as well. I want to be critical of Hollywood. And again, I've published a fair amount of stuff that's very critical of it, and I'm constantly trying to get my students to watch non-Hollywood films and films with non-white people and films, you know, not in English and not made in the United States or even Europe. But in the end of the day, there's still, you know, a couple hundred million people in the United States anyway who are interested in these kinds of things, and I'm sort of interested in why they're interested as well. Trying to figure out what their interest is. Why do they need these films? I guess I just keep coming back to that question in the end. I want to do as much as I can to get people to sort of turn people's heads and start thinking about other films and television shows. In fact, just the other day, my wife and I we sat down, we watched watched a TV show. Where did we watch? I guess we were watching Marvelous Miss Maisel, which is just kind of a fun show in a lot of ways. I think it has some pretty good issues in it. But we realized there's sort of all the shows we've watched this year, we actually haven't seen any with a white male lead in it. And none of the shows that we've sort of we don't really binge watch, but the shows we sort of followed along don't have any white male leads. And, you know, we know there's plenty of them out there. It just, we seem to have gravitated away from them. I don't think it was a conscious decision, but it's nice to be at a place where there's so much really good television and really good film that doesn't have just white men, heterosexual lead actors in the films. So don't get me wrong, there's plenty of them out there, but there's a lot of good choices now that don't include them. And so that's encouraging, I think, an encouraging place. I think these things take a long time, frustratingly long time for them to change. And, you know, with all these, as you mentioned, Mayfield's article, I'm sure so many of these Hollywood or Hallmark films are doing that, repeating that again and again. But ideally, there are other ones out there as well that are worth looking at. And so I'm sort of an optimist in that sense. I've been looking at these things for a good 30 years now, and I think things are changing. Not fast enough, but they're changing. So that's my sort of my Christmas hope. My Christmas hope is that it will look maybe someday it will look a little more like the old Coca-Cola Christmas commercials where they want to teach the world to sing, and it's a good multicultural group of people singing together.
Well, behind that, hopefully mediated though by some other sovereign.
Some other commodity.
Well, thanks so much for joining us, Brent, especially in this sort of around Christmas time season anyway. We've really appreciated reading some of the work that you're doing. We'd like to point people especially toward the research that you're up to, not just on Christmas, but on film and media. I've read your book on Walter Benjamin and art, and it's really fun and fantastic. Thanks again just for sharing some of your insights about Christmas with us.
You bet. My pleasure. Great to talk to you all.
Yeah, thanks.
Thanks for listening to the Magnificast. If you like what you heard, you can give us a little Christmas gift at patreon.com/themagnificast. And by Christmas gift, we mean a monthly donation, the gift that keeps on giving. Think of it as your subscription to the Jelly of the Month Club.
It's a ritual.
It's a ritual. That's a deep cut Christmas vacation joke. You can find us on Twitter. We're at the Magnificast. You can email us at themagnificast@gmail.com. You can, I don't know what else you can do. You can buy some last minute late Christmas gifts, because we know you did forget one special person in your life. Who it is, I don't know. But you can get some last minute gifts at redbubble.com. You can find our store there. Our music for this Christmas theme has been by Carlos Mejia Godoy, Navidad and Libertad. That's what you heard in the beginning. And our outro is by the Illogical Spoon. Next week's our last Christmas episode, so if you're sick of them, too bad. You've got one more, you Scrooge. Heaven come to earth and there won't be no church. We'll meet down by the riverside. There we'll swim with all creation. Never get tired, never bored. Don't worry, someday there'll be no dam between us and our Lord. Jackson, keep your hoods up. Keep your hoods up and you stay up late. Jackson, you keep your hoods up. Well, you keep your hoods up.